Welcome again to Art Beat. I'm Jeffrey Brown. It's that time of year again, time to wrap the presents and time to wrap the artistic year up in its glories and travesties. We're talking movies today, and we're joined by A.O. Scott, film critic for the New York Times. And welcome to you.
Hi, nice to talk to you.
So before we look at some of your favorites, I wonder if there was there an interesting theme or two for the past year, something that we might remember 2011 by?
I think there were a lot, or there are a lot of patterns that you notice, you know, when you see as many movies as I do. I'm never sure if anyone notices them, but critics who are going to the movies, you know, 4 or 5 days a week, seeing 300 or 400 a year. But a very interesting theme this year was nostalgia, and not just, you know, the usual costume dramas and look back at the past, but particularly a kind of cultural nostalgia. So you had a movie like Woody Allen's Midnight in Paris, a lovely movie, big hit, the biggest hit that Woody Allen has ever had in terms of box office, about a guy played by Owen Wilson who through some unexplained magic goes back in time in Paris and is hanging out with the Fitzgeralds and Hemingway and Dali and all of his artistic heroes, and kind of learning that you can't really live in the past quite in that way. But a lot of other movies were quite happy to live in the past. Another hit this summer was J.J. Abrams' Super 8, which was not only set in 1979, 1980, with a bunch of 12 and 13-year-old kids tracking down an alien, but was made in the style of movies of that era, as if it were a Steven Spielberg movie made in the late, you know, as if it were Close Encounters or E.T. or something like that. Then more recently, you've had Hugo, which is a tribute to by Martin Scorsese, which is in super modern 3D, a tribute to some of the earliest silent movies of the history of cinema. You have The Artist, a silent movie about the arrival of sound that's in black and white, a narrow screen. And you have Steven Spielberg's own War Horse, which is coming out around Christmas, which is not only set in the past, but evokes the big, sweeping, epic, widescreen movies of the 1950s. So there's a lot of movies that are taking us back into not just the historical past, but the movie past.
So was it also a year then for quality, for risk taking? I mean, we lament a lot of the time about the formulaic movies that come out, and still plenty of those.
Yeah.
The ones you just named have a little ambition to them.
Yeah, and I think a lot of other movies do too. And I think that there are one thing that I was very encouraged to see was a lot of movies that, you know, not just the smaller indie movies, but some of the bigger studio releases that were working sometimes within established genres, but in ways that felt very fresh and new. An example of that for me is Moneyball, which in some ways is a sports movie. It's with Brad Pitt and Jonah Hill about Billy Bean, who's the general manager of the Oakland A's earlier in this century, based on a book by Michael Lewis. But it's not really a sports movie in the classic sense, where you have it ends in the big game. It takes place in the offices, and it's about mathematics and numbers and statistics and business. I think another movie that worked nicely that way was The Descendants, starring George Clooney, which takes what is a kind of standard family comedy drama situation, a guy who is more or less widowed, reconnecting with his two young daughters, and plays that in a very fresh and original way. Much as I think one of my favorite recent movies, Young Adult, starring Charlize Theron from the team that brought us Juno, looks like your standard romantic comedy, and in fact is an almost complete and radical subversion of that genre. It's one of the harshest movies that I think I've seen all year, in the guise of something that's you know, playful and fun and romantic.
What of the sort of looking at the technical side, what of the 3D phenomenon that we focused so much in on, 2 years ago, last year, everything was starting to come out in 3D now.
Yeah.
They still are. Is it working? Is there anything we can say about it at this point?
Well, it's reached an interesting point. I think a lot of audiences, a lot of moviegoers started to resist it, started to push back against it this year. You saw the last of the Pirates of the or maybe not the last. I won't say that, but what I hope was the last of the Pirates of the Caribbean.
Wishful thinking, it sounds like, on your part.
It's, you know, it's a tough job, but I got to stick with it. But, you know, that movie was released in the 3D and the standard format and made, I think, you know, less than half of its money in 3D. And there was a lot, there were a lot of examples of people not wanting to pay that upcharge, which is whatever the theater wants to charge. So, you know, here in New York, to go see a movie in 3D, it can cost you $17 for one ticket. So, you know, if you're going with your family, a family of four, suddenly, you know, you're getting into some real money. And that's to cover the costs that the theaters have had to pay to retrofit the equipment and really not just to convert to 3D, but to full digital projection. An interesting thing that happened, though, this year is that some very accomplished filmmakers started working in the 3D format. So you had Martin Scorsese with Hugo, Steven Spielberg with Tintin, and also, most amazingly, the German filmmakers, Wim Wenders, who has a 3D documentary about the choreographer Pina Bausch called Pina, which is wonderful, and Werner Herzog, one of the most interesting and unpredictable filmmakers around, made an amazing documentary about Neolithic caves called Cave of Forgotten Dreams that was also in 3D. So on the one hand, on the commercial scale, it hasn't been doing that well, and there's a sense that maybe it's played out or it's reached a kind of limit. On the other hand, there seems to be a lot of interest in exploring some of the artistic, creative possibilities of the format. So I don't think it's dead yet. I don't think it's going to be quite the commercial juggernaut and the kind of the revolutionary force that it's been touted as being. I think it will continue to be the standard in animation. But then also you're going to see, I think, some, you know, kind of experimental 3D films, which is an intriguing idea.
So you've named lots of films already, but let me get down to your favorites for the year. Just a couple or a handful that I could lock you in a room on December 31st and make you watch them again. What would you happily watch?
I would happily watch Terrence Malick's Tree of Life. Very, you know, which was
controversial. Very controversial. I'm not with you on that, I must say, but okay.
Well, neither is my wife, but I thought that movie was just enthralling and moving, and I've been back to see it a couple times, and I just think it's such a rich and complex and unusual and ambitious work that one will definitely stay with me for a long time. Another movie that I really liked a lot is this movie called Margin Call, the first film by a guy named J.C. Shandor. Stars Kevin Spacey, Jeremy Irons, Zachary Quinto, Demi Moore. Takes place pretty much at the night of the financial collapse in 2008. And you know, in the year of Occupy Wall Street, this felt to me like the most timely and incisive and fascinating and also disturbing movie about the mindset and the way of thinking that got us into this mess that we're in, and it plays like a thriller or a horror movie, and what you're watching is a kind of apocalyptic scenario unfolding in the darkened offices of this investment bank on computer screens, and it's a terrific movie.
Is there one that we may not even have heard of? You get to see so many films, and some never get released here or don't get a wide release, certainly outside of New York, perhaps.
Yeah, my end of the year list, I try to stick to things that were released. One that I can say that I saw at the New York Film Festival, that was also at the Telluride Film Festival and at the Cannes Film Festival, that is going to come out in some kind of release early next year, I think in time to be a foreign language Oscar candidate, is this Israeli movie called Footnote. Which is one of the best things I've seen in a long time. It's a father-son drama. It's an academic comedy. It's a satire on the state of life in the state of Israel. It's one of the richest, funniest, most poignant movies. And no one should be put off by the fact that it's a movie basically about disputes within the world of Talmudic scholarship. Because if you see only one movie about Talmudic scholarship next year or in your life, Make it that one.
Can I put you on the spot for your worst film experience of the year?
That's a tough one. There's one movie that is very highly touted and has a lot of Oscar buzz that has not yet come out, so I'm not going to mention it. Tom Hanks is in it, so that's all I'll say. But the worst movie going experience, I think it's a close race between Bucky Larson, Born to Be a Star. Just even saying the name of that movie kind of makes me feel a bit ill, with Nick Swardson and Christina Ricci, about a kid from Iowa who goes to Los Angeles to become a porn star, which is just the most difficult 90 minutes at the movies, rivaled only by Jack and Jill, the most recent Adam Sandler movie. I just did not need to see Adam Sandler in kind of, you know, Jewish mother drag.
You still enjoy this 4 or 5 days a week at the movies? You enjoy what you do?
Very much. You know, it certainly beats having a real job. But it's a lot of fun. I mean, there's such a variety of movies. Every year there are so many surprises, and there are so many different kinds of movies to see and to think about. And they expose you to so many stories and to so much of the world that it's a great it's a lot of fun and a great privilege to be able to write about them.
All right. A.O. Tony Scott of The New York Times. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining us again on Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown.